The idea here is to manage, to play, to interplay between the topology of light and the topology of matter. And this towards applied things, so these optical interfaces, but which are not technologically fabricated. They are nature-assisted optical components. I will give you here just an example to introduce this model system point of view of liquid crystal. It's just a short video where we are using a liquid crystal defect on the path of an optical beam passing through that defect. And what is happening in the following, we are following this on the camera, the video is 30 seconds. This is a Gaussian beam in picture at the output of the system. If we're doing interference, we observe here ring fringes, everything is normal for a Gaussian beam. But if we switch here, the hand was switching out an electrical field that kicked the liquid crystal film and generates some defects. And the defect is shaping light. And by tuning the voltage, the defect can be disappeared, reappearing, and shape the light in a dynamical way. Thus constructing some building block, which is a model system. Why? Because topological richness of liquid crystal is very huge. You can have different kind of defects, mean different kind of topological structuring for the light field. Which means that the matter acts mechanically on the light, to some point of view, it makes its voltage. Here we're interested in something different, in the action of light on the matter, not the reverse, which means optomechanics. But optomechanics is a specific flavor, the flavor of chirality. So broken inversion symmetry, as your two hands, right and left. And the idea is to present the two candidates of the day. Liquid crystals that can present spontaneous chiral mesophases. For example, here, a supramolecular orientation of anisotropic molecules that arrange into a helical shape spatial configuration as shown here. And depending on the chirality of the molecules, of the mixture, of the liquid crystal mixture, it could be left-handed or right-handed helix. For the light, the counterpart in terms of chirality, considering circularly polarized light, let's say the Gaussian beam, plane wave, will have right-handed or left-handed circular polarization associated with the spatiotemporal structure of the electric field in the form of helical arrangement. And the idea here is to discuss to which extent the interplay between these two chiralities, one of matter and the one of light, can be used to demonstrate in the lab some proof of principle or first steps of something in the field of chiral resolution. And what is chiral resolution? Chiral resolution is the fact that if you have a collection of chiral entities, consider two guys here, blue and red, right and left labelings. In general, when you are fabricating those kind of entities, mixtures, could be towards the synthesis of a drug, for example, because chiral molecules are bioactive in a selective manner. So when you are using some drugs to cure you, you are using, in most generally, chiral molecules. But those chiral molecules will give them chirality. If it's the other chirality, that molecule won't be a drug, but a poison, for example. So what you have to do is that when you prepare this, you need to separate them. So those industries playing with drug preparation, for example, they need to have systems to separate right entities from left entities after the fabrication. And this is the general protocol, how they do. They got some hands, which are called, in practice, is some technology, chiral chromatography, and they are separating mechanically at the end of the process, the left are on the left, the right are on the right, and then you can collect them and prepare what you need to prepare. And the idea is that could we, instead of material hands, which are the cases of chiral chromatography, could we develop some optical hands to do the job? Could we use light? If we want to use light to perform chiral resolution, it means we need to use light and to have a mechanical action on matter. Mechanical action means redistribution either of linear momentum to lead to displacement through the appearance of force, or to play with the distribution of angular momentum, which can be spin or orbital, here spin only, and to lead to torques and rotational motions. The idea here is that we have to talk, optomechanically speaking, we have to talk this chirality of matter, which means we need to be sensitive to chirality, which means that we have to apply this light, some force, which is dependent on the chirality of matter. For that, we need a kind of broken symmetry to talk selectively, to interact selectively with the chiral material systems. And the idea is to use what I call here cross effect, to use the angular momentum of light, here the spin angular momentum of light, so the elasticity parameter lambda will drive all the mechanisms presented thereafter, and to apply a force that depends on the elasticity of light, but also on the chirality of matter. By doing so, we'll control the force exerted on the matter, which is represented here. Depending on the relative chirality of the light field and on the materials of the material system, if we have a typical situation like that, that the interacting chiral medium is scattering the light differently depending on the relative chirality of light and matter, in that case we will have chiral dependent forces, which means discriminatory optical forces regarding the chirality. So you will have a particle, and depending on the elasticity, if the parameter chirality key is fixed, depending on the applied elasticity, so experimentally on the applied handedness of your circular polarization state that illuminates your system, you will have different forces. So to demonstrate this in the laboratory, we need to perform, of course, an experiment. And to perform an experiment as the first step towards this this proposal, we need something simple, at least. So the idea is to have an object which is free to move, easy to prepare, and which has a strong elasticity-dependent scattering manifestation. And for that, the idea is simply to use liquid crystals. So these are the coming as of the model system. We take a glass of water, a drop of pneumatic liquid crystal droplet, so we add a little bit of chiral compound to create this helical ordering of the liquid crystal, chiral mesophase here. And by shaking this, actually the system spontaneously forms emulsion of spherical droplets whose internal three-dimensional distribution of the local helical distribution of the molecules is actually radial, in other words, well-defined. And the topology of that object is well-controlled and is provided by nature. So we have here a model system, this one is robust, and we'll use it as the building block to perform experimental demonstration of chiral optical resolution. So the elasticity-dependent scattering of these objects actually needs a step back from the droplet, which is a 3D object, to a simple helix, a one-dimensional chiral system. When you are launching a circularly polarized plane wave along the optical axis, along the helical axis of the chiral liquid crystal, actually depending on the chirality of the liquid crystal and the elasticity of light, you have either full transmission or full reflection. This is called the circular Bragg reflection phenomenon, which occurs in a specific region in the spectral domain, which is called the circular photonic band gap. And so this can be characterized from spectroscopic measurements. So this is a fact. And the idea is to explore, to use that fact, that strong elasticity scattering, dependent scattering, in 3D with our object. So the idea is, what about the Bragg phenomenon, circular Bragg phenomenon in 3D? So the answer is in these two pictures. We took here a droplet of liquid crystal with being right-handed, and we look the image of light after some circular right or left incident polarization state of light passes through. In one case we see the droplet with some light passing through, and in the other case, when the product is equal to minus one, it turns out that you have a black disk. What does it mean, that black disk? It means that in that region, in that solid angle, all incident photons have been reflected back by the spherical mirror represented by the droplet, which means that we have a strong redistribution in space of the incident linear momentum and strong elasticity-dependent force, which is pictured here. where the body force, here F, that depends on elasticity, is applied on a droplet which is immersed in a liquid and illuminated by a circularly polarized Gaussian beam. And the result of the experiment is shown here. As you can see here, at zero time, so reduced time tau means that at zero laser is on, at one laser is off. So this is eliminated moment duration. And as you can see, the droplet has a given position here, velocity is zero, which is just detected by video recording of the droplet in the tank. And when light is on, almost instantaneously, we have a given velocity, finite, that we can measure. And that velocity depends on the circular polarization and depends also on the chirality of the droplet. So we have two kinds of velocity. One is called velocity bright, the other one velocity anti-bright. These are the two levels A and B. And we can measure them. And we can check experimentally that the effect is not only robust and reproducible, but also preserves the structure of the droplet, which means we can really consider that everything is fixed. We can just focus on the interaction. Here is just a polarizing microscopy imaging of the dynamics, just to check that the structure is unchanged. There is nothing special but the light matter interaction in terms of the scattering. This kind of bit of process can be very simply described, actually. Not only it's robust, but it is simple, even in terms of modeling. Rheoptics is doing the job. The droplets are not that small. Here we are dealing with 10 micron diameter, typically, for the droplets. So rheoptics, you can consider the redistribution of rays by refraction, reflections, and you will have such an elementary force exerted on an elementary surface element of the droplet. Here, the radiation pressure, you will recognize effective elementary area upon angle upon theta, this is normal. You have a function here that depends on how many refraction, the rays, the course of the ray during the interaction, and you integrate to get the total force. You do a little bit of hydrodynamics to describe the velocity, depending on the fluid environment, at rest, not at rest, etc. You shake everything, and then you have some description. And that description is working well, and well enough, actually, to describe quantitatively the contrast. So, which means the discriminatory number that tells you if the action is a success or not a success. A success means that the discriminatory force is full. Full means you have C, which is 1, which means that one velocity is 0, while the other is something. In that case, it's really the effect is maximum, the relative effect is maximum. And for one beam, which was presented the slide before, we can measure experimentally, we can model, simply injecting the parameters used in the experiment, a contrast which is roughly half. Okay, not bad. The effect is here, the effect is present, but it's not optimal. You're in the lab in front of your experiment, you want to optimize once you get an effect. To optimize, actually, we have to realize that we are trapped by something. That something is the fact that the droplet, whatever is chirality, anyway, will scatter light. So even when there is not this strong light-matter interaction in the non-Bragg case, you still have some scattering. So if you want to have a full discriminatory force manifestation, you need to cancel, you need to rule that residual scattering, which is simply done by adding a second beam, a contra-circular propagating beam, so with the same velocity, and in that case you are exactly compensating the residual scattering, and in that case you're happy, you have a fully discriminatory force simply changing the elasticity of one beam. And the idea is to use that towards pure resolution. So then imagine you're, let's go for a bowling party. We are launching the droplet in the flow, and they are passing through two counterpropagating beams. One is with a given elasticity, and the other one has the same elasticity. So if the particle is non-chiral, it will be pushed in the same way, right and left. And it's the same power, so strictly the particle should go straight. But if the particle is non-chiral, in that case, the elasticity of light fields being fixed, the experience interaction now differs from the beam coming from the right of the particle or to the left of the particle. In that case, the left-handed particle will be deflecting in one direction, while the other chirality will be deflected in the opposite direction. Experimentally, the results is shown here. From top to bottom, the droplet is flowing and enter the interaction region here. As you can see here, the left-handed particle experiences more scattering from this helicity 1 than helicity minus 1. And then it is deflected in a given direction. If now we reproduce the same experiment, have we mentioned? Yeah. But changing the chirality of the droplet, you can experience the interaction because there is scattering. You can see that the droplet is just sparkling a bit. And it's deflected in the opposite direction. While if it's a non-chiral particle, like oil, for example, or non-chiral liquid crystal, it still interacts with light. As you can see, it passes through light. It scatters light, but in a non-discriminatory way. In that case, the droplet goes straight forward. And you can see the typical, we are speaking about tens of micrometer per second in terms of velocity, and typically couple of hundreds of milliwatts. So we are speaking lab demonstration. The summary is here, just to appreciate the symmetry of the effect. So it's a college, just a snapshot superpositions for the two cases. All this is working so far in a very specific situation, which are the Bragg particles. But actually we checked that even with non-Bragg particle, it still works. Bragg phenomenon is just optomechanically enhancing this discriminatory force. The chirality is enough to do the job. As an experiment, we show here the case of a fully detuned Bragg particle. So for the visible light, the band gap is so far, it does not experience it in a direct manner. But still, the tail of the Bragg, if you can speak qualitatively like that, you can still experience it and have with larger power a smaller deviation, but still you have the effect. So the effect is very general. General enough and robust enough to consider the possibility to use this in a microfluidic environment and to sort in a 100% manner chiral particle right or left. But these are very specific particles, the liquid crystal, chiral particle, and droplets. If those droplets, you consider them as like kind of trucks on which you can load with some entities you want really to sort at the nanoscale, for example. In that case, you will have such a scheme. You are loading the truck that you have prepared to be ready to receive in a selective manner one entity or another, as shown here. And in a blind manner, in a passive manner, light is redirecting the two kinds of particles, which means at the same time we are redirecting the nano entities that have been selectively binded to the particles. So this is the way that we are going on in that. You can see here an experimental picture of the experimental work in progress in terms of this microfluidic solvent. So for the 5 minutes that remains for that talk, I will now extend a bit these chiral forces to something else. We were speaking about optical ends here to push right or to push left in a selective manner, right or left-handed particles. The idea is, can we do a bit, can we be more subtle? Can we go with, as Pasteur did with the tartaric acid crystals resolution, where he was looking the crystals, if they were right, if they were left. And with a tweezer, mechanical tweezer, he was taking one by one, sorting them, and then doing some optical experiment to stop the field of enantiochemistry. And the idea, could we use light as those kind of tweezers? Could we use optical fingers? And this image is very well representative. Finger right or finger left, and could we create some chiral optical tweezers that are selective to the chirality of the matter? So using the ray optics model that I briefly introduced, we can predict, we can design an experiment which is a priori non-trivial to predict where are the location of chiral tweezing. Okay, a priori is not something obvious, so first we explore the system in a theoretical manner, And for a given situation with this two-beam configuration of identical helicity, contrapropagating, both circular, and the droplet placed here, we just evaluate whether this one is trapped whatever the chirality product or for a given product. Blue means chiral sensitivity, which means chiral twisting. So we place the droplet, we just design an on-demand droplet, let's say A, droplet B, as shown here. So droplet B, if we switch the helicity product from plus 1 to minus 1, simply by reversing the circular polarization handedness, these trapped, these are image of trapped droplets, B should be still trapped, and this one should be detrapped. And after a few seconds after switching, actually this is what is happening. So we can conclude that actually we're able to go blindly with our tweezer, optical tweezer, to go in the tank, and the winner is always with a given handedness. So this kind of tweezer has been fully characterized in terms of optical force field and stiffness. I mean, the full characterization has been done experimentally. We have really 3D chiral tweezers, they are stable. And actually, I won't present here, but we have generalized them to more, I would say, involved chirality features for the light field by also considering vortex chiral tweezers. I won't speak here about that, but I will just conclude with that slide. And so this is just summarizing the presentation. I would like to insist on the last line in red. I presented discriminatory optical forces for chiral matter. But also we have explored discriminatory optical torques. This morning, at least one presentation mentioned that, oh, there is at the reflection, at the entrance of the system, when probing whatever tissue, there is a helicity flipped reflection that is used as a trick to get nice image free from background. Here, this chiral system has cholesteric liquid crystals, those systems we are using, the helicity is preserved at the bright reflection. And from that helicity preservation, there are very nice angular momentum interplay, exchange between light and matter, if you make the angular momentum balance. And you can have interesting torque manifestation, but clearly this is another talk, so I'm stopping here. Thank you for your attention.
Time for questions? Yes, anybody? Huh? Yes, please.
Thank you very much. I would like to ask you if there is a particular size. You see that size matters when you take this kind of particular. Have you explored the need for the thickness of the particle lines with the other, for instance, protein lines?
Or in terms of size, that arrangement that we are exploiting to get what I would call the noctomechanical resonant effect, a strong resonance, we need that radial ordering of the helix, of the supramolecular helices. For that, the size should not be too small. If it's too small, the surface effect will impose another topological distribution, another kind of structuring in the bulk of the droplet. What is this cutoff radius? Let's say typically, let's say 1 micron. Above 1 micron is totally fine. Whatever is the size of the droplet, you will always have, under appropriate boundary conditions, you will always have this kind of structuring in 3D. Now, regarding the force as a function of the size, the force is somehow a product of intensity, so it will be the radiation pressure from which results an optical force exerted on the droplets. So it's a product of, let's say, in the effective intercepted area, the Bragg disk. It scales as a droplet radius, so we have here R square factor for the optical force. So the smaller is the particle, the smaller is the force. So this is a limitation, but playing a couple of micron of diameter particle, it was, I would say, easily, relatively easily and robustly detectable for a proof of principle. Of course, with the aim as going toward nanoscale sorting, which is kind of great for that activity, could we sort molecules by light? This is a huge challenge, because if you go to the level of the nano entity, for example, the force will go from piconewton to femtonewton. Femtonewton means buoyant motion in the round and start to annoy you. So you have to develop some tricks, so we are not giving up. But it's really challenging and argued in the community whether it's really even like worse to study. So of course, scientifically, it's worse to explore, and we're on that way.
Okay. Yes.
The most general small particle will have not only chirality, but also biaxial birefringence, and also absorption that's anisotropic with not necessarily the same axes. Now, of course, this means that the most general force that you would get, even assuming the particle is small and neglecting the higher multiples, would depend in some complicated way on all of these effects. Did you look at the interactions between biaxiality and chirality, for example?
No. What I can say is that to replace with appropriate wording the which kind of force we are dealing with. We are dealing here it's a non-dissipative like matter interaction process. Which means that here, if you are aware about the like matter interaction in chiral media, there is circular decreasing related to elicity dependent absorption, and there is circular birefringence. And actually here, which is optical activity in another also wording. And that here it's a manifestation of optical activity, if you wish here. So of course, if in presence of, for example, full only circular dichroism effect, it's also you will also have this kind of discriminatory force, and then it's become more tricky because then of course you have local heating, you have microflow around your particle, and that's become a serious story. Interesting but complicated. That's why for starter we were starting with a very simple model system just to gain confidence to explore more complicated things.
Thank you.
Last question?
Yes. Did you investigate what happened if you have a dense collection of particles?
Yes. So I would like to go there. So as I told you, experiments are in progress in 1D. Of course, yeah, there is a tank at the output of the microchannel. So we have emulsions, well-controlled emulsions, and, which means that then if you start to interact with an emulsion, you will have, if you have a local motion, you have a non-local interaction, and that mediated by hydrodynamic flows around the displaced particle in the fluid, in the viscous fluid. And this leads to collective effects which are understood in 2D and in 3D.
Okay, let's thank Professor Brasilia once again.
Thank you.